In this video here, we're going to run a web application, a web server, on an EC2 instance, and this web server, this web application, will actually use the AWS SDK to interact with the DynamoDB service, so with another AWS service. Now, since this web application will use that other service, it will also need appropriate permissions for that. And therefore, in this video here, we're not just going to run this web application on EC2, but we're also going to make sure that sufficient permissions, access permissions, access rights, are provided to the EC2 instance and the workload, the web application running on top of it. I'll head over to EC2 and now start a new server. And that, of course, is done with the launch wizard again. And in here, I'll stick to the basic AMI, basic instance type. I don't need a key pair. And I'll also stick to the basic network settings. I just want to make sure that I do attach a security group that does allow HTTP traffic. We theoretically don't even need SSH traffic, but we can also turn it on so that we could connect to the instance to manually install extra software or anything like that. Now, one brief word about the VPC and subnet, it does not matter here. The instance here, of course, should be in a public subnet since we will run a web server on it that should be reachable from the internet. But DynamoDB does not care about VPCs and subnets at all. You don't launch databases into subnets with DynamoDB. Instead, DynamoDB just cares about the region you selected, and that's it. You then connect to DynamoDB through the AWS SDK anyways, and that SDK actually will need AWS credentials to successfully connect to DynamoDB, so to the DynamoDB service, as you will see in a couple of minutes. So therefore here, we don't have to worry about the VPC or subnets at all, as long as the EC2 instance is in a public subnet. But now we have a very important setting down there, which we have to choose, and that is the IAM instance profile. Now, that's a setting we haven't seen in one of the other videos, but it's an important setting here for this instance and this use case. Since we're directly talking to the DynamoDB service and not to some database server that's exposed through the network, we have to authenticate the requests we send to this service. Because here, in the end, we're programmatically accessing an AWS service. And we could do that through the management console as well. Just as we can launch EC2 instances through the management console, we can also reach out to DynamoDB and not just create our tables here, but we could also explore the table items and therefore query or scan the data in that database table. There is a slight difference between these terms, but in the end, both operations retrieve data from the database table. And we can also create items, so we can put items into this DynamoDB table. And that is, again, some interaction we did not have when using RDS and the database server managed through RDS. So we can directly interact with our DynamoDB service and the data here through that DynamoDB service. And the AWS SDK can also be used to interact with it. We could also use the SDK to create a table, but here we're just using it to put and retrieve data. So essentially here, we're using the AWS SDK as we could use it to launch EC2 instances, or as we could use the AWS CLI to launch instances or talk to DynamoDB. We're using that service programmatically here. And such requests must be authenticated. And we can authenticate programmatic requests through our access keys. When we create accounts and IAM users, those can have access keys, which we can use for programmatic access with help of the CLI or the AWS SDKs. But of course, here, the application that should actually access DynamoDB will run on an EC2 instance. And we don't want to store access keys on that instance. That would be considered a bad practice. Instead, what we can and should do is add an IAM instance profile. And that is simply an IAM role, which we can create and attach to this EC2 instance so that the permissions granted by that role will be granted to the processes running on top of that instance. So for example, here our application needs permission to put data onto a DynamoDB table and to scan a DynamoDB table to retrieve all data and to query a DynamoDB table to retrieve some filtered data. So we need put, scan, and query access as well as get command access for getting a single item. So put, scan, query, and get. These are the actions that must be allowed to the process running on top of this EC2 instance. And therefore, in the IAM management console, we want to create a new role that can be assumed by the EC2 instance. Now, that role should have an AWS service as the trusted entity, so basically as the entity to which it will be assigned. And here we can select EC2 from the common use case list here, because this is indeed a very common use case that we have an EC2 instance that should have a certain role attached to it. Lambda would be another very common use case, but here we'll stick to EC2 and create that role. Now, next, we need to define the policy or pick the policy that should be attached to the role. And the policy is the actual thing that defines the concrete permissions that will be provided. Now, here I'll create a new policy, and we can use this visual editor. If you're more advanced, you can also use the JSON editor and write it all from scratch. But here I'll use this visual editor to describe the kind of permissions I want to grant. And here the permissions I want to grant are related to the DynamoDB service. Because on that service, I want to grant certain reading permissions. To be precise, the get item, query, and scan permissions. These are the permissions our code needs. But besides reading, it also must be able to write, and to be precise, it should be able to put items into the database, or into a table, to be precise. Now, if our code would create a table, then we should also grant this permission, for example, but here we're not doing that, so put item is all we need. Now, I will also define for which tables these permissions should be granted, and you do that here under resources. There, we specify the table for which these permissions should be granted. And here, my tables are in the US East 1 region, and then it's the topics table. And then also in the US East 1 region, the opinions table. So now these permissions here will be granted for these tables to whoever has this policy attached. Therefore, now we can click next. We could add tags here. And then review this and give it a name. And here I'll simply name this demo DynamoDB read write. The name is up to you, but it should of course kind of describe what this policy does, which kind of permissions it grants. So here I create that policy. And once this policy was created, we can go back here to our role, refresh, and then look for this demo policy. Here it is actually. This is now a custom policy, a customer-managed policy, instead of a pre-created policy managed by AWS. And we can, of course, adjust and tweak this policy and the permissions granted by it whenever we need to. When this policy is added to a role that's attached to some entity, and we then tweak that policy thereafter, that entity automatically also receives any extra permissions we might grant in the future. So here we add this policy to this role, and I'll name this role EC2 DynamoDB demo. So that's now my role name. And that role can be assumed by EC2. That's what this trusted entity thing says. It defines who can assume this role. And then we have this permission added, which defines some read and write permissions for certain DynamoDB tables. Now, with that role created, back here in the EC2 launch wizard, we can refresh and then pick this instance profile. And now any processes running on that EC2 instance will have the permissions granted through that role. Now with that set, I will just also paste in some user data which I prepared in advance. Some user data which downloads the code, installs Node.js, and starts the Node.js server. And with that, we can launch this instance. and then wait for it to start up and initialize and install all that software and start the web server. And thereafter, we can try interacting with it. And under the hood, we will talk to these database tables and store the data in these database tables with help of the role that grants the appropriate permissions. So I'll be back once this is up and running and once all the software was installed and the web server is up and running. So now here, after a couple of minutes, the website is up and running. And now I can share some statements here and click onto them and also share some opinions. And all that data is now saved in DynamoDB. And we can view it there by going to these tables and querying these tables by simply hitting refresh here or by running our own queries or scans. With scans, we select all the table items. With queries, we can actually filter based on the partition key and if defined our sort key. So here I see one opinion, and in the topics table, I see one topic. I can click onto it and view and also edit all the data. And that's also pretty important because, as mentioned before, this was not possible like that with RDS. With DynamoDB, it's totally normal because there is no difference between the database and accessing the database data and managing the service or using the service. Instead, the service is the database. And that's why we also had to use these SDK commands in order to interact with that database and store and retrieve our data with help of that AWS SDK. So that's DynamoDB in action here connected with an EC2 based web server. And I'll now just clean up all these things and delete these tables because I don't need them anymore now that the demo is finished. And of course, also shut down this instance. We can also get rid of that role and policy to clean up unnecessary resources, which we don't need anymore, so that over time our account doesn't get bloated with unnecessary unused resources. That's why I will also select this role and delete it and enter its name to confirm deletion, and then also go to policies and select my custom policy and delete it so that this is also not there if we don't need it.